سبيل الدموع سبيل مريح تنهدى يا صاحي كي تستريح.
All praises due to Allah. May Allah send His peace and blessings upon His final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. O you who have believed, fear Allah as He deserves to be feared and die only in the sight of Islam. My dear brothers, today we'll share with you some words of advice from Al-Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, the great companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, his cousin and his son-in-law and the fourth of the Khulafa al-Rashideen, known for his great wisdom. He said, I advise you with five words. And if you were to ride the backs of the camels for great distances, you would not find advice better than this. Save yourself a lot of trouble and listen to these five points of advice. He said, first of all, a person, a servant of Allah, should not fear anything except for his sins. The greatest thing a Muslim should fear is his own sins. Many people are occupied with the sins of others and forget about their own sins. The thing that will cause your destruction in this world and in the hereafter is your own sins. As we all know, sins are what cause the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. And that a person will be punished on the Day of Judgment because of his sins and his disobedience to Allah. But also, sins are a cause of destruction and hardship for a person even in this worldly life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, and never are you befallen with any calamity, except it is but what your hands have earned. And Allah pardons much. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to account us and punish us for all our sins, we'd be completely destroyed. But Allah pardons much. He only punishes us for little. And His punishment for our sins is a mercy, because it is a wake-up call for us to come back and turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَنُذِيقَنَّهُمْ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَدْنَى دُونَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَكْبَرِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. And surely we will let them taste a small portion of pain and torment before the large torment, the torment of the Day of Judgment, in hope that they return back to Allah. The thing that we should fear the most is our sins. Wallahi, you shouldn't even fear an enemy of the East and the West and the armies and so on, but rather fear your sins, because it is from the sins that will cause the destruction. And it is only by your obedience to Allah that will give you your strength. Your strength to succeed in this world and your strength to succeed in the hereafter. The second point of advice from Imam Ali radiallahu anhu is that a person should not have hope in anyone except his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala controls the affairs of the heavens and the earth. Every being in this world, whether it is living or non-living, it is under the control of Allah. So if you want something to happen, seek that from Allah, who can turn the universe to fulfill what Allah wishes of good for you. And if you seek to be protected from any harm, then have hope in Allah, who has power over the whole universe, that can protect you from any harm that you seek from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whereas if you seek and have hope for goodness or for protection from a creation, the creation is limited, the creation is weak, and the creation would disappoint you sooner or later. But if you have hope in Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never disgrace you, will never disappoint you. Have hope in Allah and only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave advice to Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said, if you ask, then ask from Allah. And if you seek help, then seek help only in Allah. This is how we should live our life as Muslims. The third point of advice is that a person should not feel shy to learn if they do not know. Many people refrain from learning because they are too shy. They are too shy to admit that they don't know. They are too shy because they feel that now they are in old age. But do not be shy to learn if you don't know. The majority of the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, they became Muslim in their senior age. when they were adults, and many of them when they were senior. But that did not stop them from learning, and even sitting with the young boys and learning the simple things of the religion. The scholars, they say two types of people will never learn. Someone who is arrogant, someone who's too proud to admit that he doesn't know, someone who's too proud to sit in a lesson, someone who's too proud to sit with people who are of lower status or of younger age than him, he will never learn. And also the one who is too shy, too embarrassed as well, he will never learn. We have to break this shyness. This is false shyness. And we have to learn if we do not know. We have to admit that if we do not know, and we should not be too shy to admit it, and we should learn the religion of Allah. Until when will you delay learning? You say, I'm too old now, I can't learn. Until when? You're only getting older. Don't you feel embarrassed? Don't you feel shy that you will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you have not achieved what you wish to achieve in your religion? Wouldn't you feel shy to meet Allah and you haven't learned how to read the Quran in proper Arabic and proper Tajweed? Wouldn't you feel shy in meeting Allah and you don't know the basics and fundamentals of your religion? Many people there, you know, are happy to say, you know, I know generally about Islam. But if you come and you ask them, or if a person's new to Islam, and come and teach them, nah, brother, I don't know. Why? Every Muslim should gain knowledge and be one who is able to teach himself and teach his family and teach others. The fourth point is that a person should not feel shy to say, I don't know, if he doesn't know. Many people in their gatherings, when they're gathering with their friends or their family, and a religious question is raised, you find everyone has an opinion. I think this, and I heard this, and I. When it comes to the religion, everyone has an opinion. No one says, I don't know. Everyone knows. But if there is a medical issue, someone says, Wallah, I've got this pain or whatever, no one says, you know, you should take this or do that. Or the doctor gave you this medicine. No, 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 don't listen to that doctor. Stop taking the medicine. No one would dare to do that. He says, Wallah, I don't know about medicine. Ask an expert. If someone has a legal problem, he's going to court or whatever, no one will say to him, no, you should do this and you should say this and don't worry about this lawyer, just go and do this. No one will give you advice if they don't have qualification in that. And he'll say, Wallah, I don't know. Go and ask someone who has knowledge in law and so on. But why, when it comes to the religion, everyone's got an opinion. No one says, Wallah, I don't know. Ask an expert. Don't be shy to say, I don't know. Many times a person is put in a situation, mashallah, you go to the masjid, you attend the Jummah, mashallah, what do you think? If you don't know, don't be shy to say, I don't know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that of the great sins is to speak about the religion of Allah without knowledge. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned that after shirk. And in that sequence, it makes speaking about the religion of Allah without knowledge greater than shirk. So a person has to beware of speaking about the religion of Allah without knowledge. If you are not sure, then say, I don't know. And ask a person with knowledge. Finally, the importance of patience. The fifth point of advice is patience. And the status of patience in faith is like the status of the head with the rest of the body. There is no value to a body with no head. And likewise, there is no value of faith without patience. Sometimes you have a brother, mashallah, he has knowledge and he comes to the masjid and he prays and he fasts and he gives charity. But then when it comes a time where he's put in a corner or his anger is enraged, he loses his patience. And he says, brother, sorry, I can't help myself. I don't have sabr. I've got everything except sabr. Faith without patience, without sabr, is useless. Because it is patience that will get you to paradise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّ الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Allah will fulfill the reward of the patient ones without any end. It is the patient ones who get to paradise. Because it is only with patience that you obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is only with patience that you stay away from what Allah has forbidden. And as the scholars said, that never does a person fall into sin except it is because of his weakness and his lack of patience. There is no excuse to fall into sin. The only reason a person falls into sin is because he's not patient enough. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not obligate upon a person more than he can bear, nor does Allah forbid upon a person something that is beyond his ability to abstain from. And so many people, they make excuses for their sins. And they say, brother, I can't. Or they say to themselves, wallah, I have to do this sin. I can't be patient enough. It's because you're weak. It's because you're not patient enough. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to strengthen us. And as well, the third type of patience is to be patient during times of hardship and calamity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ, and give glad tidings to those who are patient. Those, when they are struck with a calamity, they say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Verily we belong to Allah, and verily to Allah we shall return. It is with these advice, my dear brothers. Be concerned of your sins. Have hope in Allah. Don't be shy to learn if you don't know. Don't be shy to say, I don't know. And be patient. For patience is the key to your faith and the key to entering paradise and to be saved from the hellfire. إخواني في الله خطبتنا اليوم ستختصر على وصية من حكم وصايا الإمام علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه وهذا من بليغ كلامه رضي الله عنه فقال لا يخافن عبد إلا ذنبه ولا يرجون أحدكم إلا ربه ولا يستحي أن يتعلم إذا لا يعلم ولا يستحي أن يقول لا أعلم والصبر كالرأس من الجسد ومنزلة الصبر من الإيمان كمنزلة الرأس من الجسد ولا فائدة لجسد بلا رأس كما أنه لا فائدة لإيمان بدون صبر. إذا وجدنا إلى هذه الوصية وهذه الكلمات النيرة الحكيمة نجدها أنها منهج للمسلم في حياته. أولا من وصايا الإمام علي رضي الله عنه لا يخافن أحد إلا ذنبه. إذا الإنسان نظر إلى نفسه واقتصر إلى ذنبه أغناه عن الخوض في مشاكل الناس وذنوب الناس. بعض الناس ينشغل بذنوب الناس وينسى ذنبه هو. المصيبة كل المصيبة في الدنيا والآخرة من ذنب الإنسان نفسه. كل المصائب ليس فقط الأخروية بل حتى الدنيوية سببها الذنوب. يقول الله تبارك وتعالى وما أصابكم من مصيبة فبما كسبت أيديكم ويعفو عن كثير. وما أصابكم من مصيبة, وهذه عامة شاملة لكل المصائب الدنيوية والأخروية, فبما كسبت أيديكم. وهناك أدلة كثيرة في القرآن والسنة على أن المصائب الدنيوية هي بسبب الذنوب. والله العظيم لا ينبغي للإنسان أن يخاف من أي شيء ولا يخاف من عدو, بل عليه أن يخاف من ذنبه, لأنها سبب لمهلكته في الدنيا وسبب لعذابه في الآخرة. فإذا اجتهد الإنسان أن يجتنب المعاصي والذنوب وأن يتوب إذا ما وقع في الذنب فذلك أجدر به. ثانيا كان يقول ولا يرجون أحدكم إلا ربه. الإنسان الذي يرجو المخلوق فإن المخلوق ضعيف وقوته قاصرة, فإنه كثير ما يؤول إلى الفشل وييأس الإنسان إذا اتكل إلى مخلوق, ولكنه إذا رجا خالقه سبحانه وتعالى وإذا رجا ربه فإن الله تبارك وتعالى لا يخيب مَنْ رَجَى بِهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى لِأَنَّ كُلَّ خَيْرٍ بِيَدِ اللَّهِ فَإِذَا أَرَدْتَ خَيْرًا فَارْجُوا ذَلِكَ الْخَيْرَ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِي يَمْلِكُ دَفْعَ الضُّرْ هُوَ اللَّهِ فَالَّذِي يُرِيدُ أَنْ يَكْشُفَ الضُّرْ فعليه أن يرجو الله سبحانه وتعالى بأن يكشف ضره يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى وما أصاب والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال في الحديث إذا سألت فاسأل الله وإذا استعنت فاستعن بالله لا ينبغي لأحد أن يرجو إلا الله سبحانه وتعالى والله سبحانه وتعالى لا يخيب من رجا به. ثالثا لا يستحي أن يتعلم إذا كان لا يعلم. كثير من الناس يمنعهم التعلم بسبب الحياء. وعلينا أن نتذكر أن معظم جل الصحابة تعلموا في كبر سنهم. أسلموا وهم كبار وتعلموا حتى لو جلسوا مع الصغار. كثير من الناس يترك التعلم لأنه أصبح كبيراً وقال العلماء هناك اثنان لا يتعلمان المتكابر والمستحي المتكابر لا يقر بأنه جاهل ويتكابر أن يجلس ويتعلم فهذا لا يتعلم أبداً والذي يستحي أيضاً لا يتعلم علينا أن نتعلم ولو كنا كباراً ولو كنا أصحاب جاه علينا أن نقر إذا كنا ما نعلم أن نتعلم رابعاً ولا يستحي أن يقول لا أعلم وهذا كثير اليوم ترى الناس إذا جلسوا في مجالسهم كل الناس يخوض في دين الله وإذا أثيرت مسألة دينية ترى كل إنسان له رأي ولكن إذا أثيرت قضية طبية شخص مريض عنده ألم يخاف الإنسان أن يوصيه بشيء في الطب أو إذا كان عند إنسان قضية قانونية يخاف الإنسان أن يرشده بشيء قانوني يقول لا أعلم اسأل متخصص أما في الدين فكل إنسان يكون له رأي إذا كان الإنسان لا يعلم فعليه أن يقول لا أعلم ولا يتجرأ على أن يقول في دين الله ما لا يعلم لأن الله سبحانه وتعالى جعل القول في دين الله بلا علم في درجة أعظم من الشرك يقول الله عز وجل وأن تشركوا بالله ما لم ينزل به سلطانا وأن تقولوا على الله ما لا تعلمون فالقول في دين الله ما لا يعلم بمنزلة أعظم من منزلة الشرك بالله وهذه مسألة خطيرة إذا أراد الإنسان أن يحفظ دينه فعليه أن يمسك لسانه وإذا ما أثيرت قضية وهو لا يعلم حكمها فعليه أن يمسك لسانه ويقول لا أعلم ويسأل صاحب علم خامسا وأخيرا الصبر بمنزلة الإيمان كمنزلة الرأس من الجسد هناك بعض الناس ربما عنده إيمان وربما عنده مظاهر الإيمان والتزام وصلاة وصدقة وصيام وصلاة وغير ذلك ولكن إذا وقع في حرج تراه سريع الغضب لا يستطيع أن يتملك نفسه وإذا قلت له اصبر يقول يتعذر ويقول لا أستطيع هذه نقطة لا أستطيع بها وهذا خطأ لا ينبغي لمؤمن أن يتخلى عن الصبر فإن الصبر بمنزلة الرأس إذا كان هناك جسد عظيم قوي ولكن بدون رأس فليس هناك فائدة من ذلك الجسد الصبر قضية مهمة يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى إنما يوفى الصابرون أجرهم بغير حساب الصابر ينال الأجر عند الله سبحانه وتعالى ويقول الله عز وجل عن أهل الجنة أنهم يحيون في الجنة سلام عليكم بما صبرتم الصبر هي مفتاح الجنة لأن بالصبر تنال طاعة الله سبحانه وتعالى وبالصبر تترك معصية الله سبحانه وتعالى ويقول الله سبحانه وتعالى أيضا عن ثالث أنواع الصبر الصبر على قضاء الله وقدره يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى وبشر الصابرين الذين إذا أصابتهم مصيبة قالوا إن لله وإنا إليه راجعون وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الصبر ضياء ضياء للمؤمن فكيف يسير المؤمن في حياته إذا ما كان عنده النور والضياء الذي ينور طريقه فالصبر هو ضياء للمؤمن
فبالله كم تستطب القروح ويبرأ جروح الكسير الجريح وينشط ذاك السقيم العليل وقد كان بالسقم دهرا